something. Like, it's bad.
It's not bad.
Well, yeah, in Chinese, of course, obviously.
Sounds bad.
It sounds bad.
It's cool. It's a cool brand. I have one of his shirts. It's super high quality, and the shirt is. I love it.
I need in to get some.
We're
streaming live, everyone. Woo!
On
stream.
See us live. Oh, we are now. All right, guys.
There
welcome
go, okay.
to the stream.
Welcome, everyone. I think we'll close the door. Do we want to close
the
door?
Yeah, let's
close
the door. Close
the door. Okay, cool.
So we don't have that light there.
Okay. I have no idea where I'm standing. Okay, well.
Stand wherever you want.
Welcome to Judge Classes. I'm Jeremiah. I will be teaching them along with... We have Tony over here on the computer. And we have
Hi,
Kai.
Tony.
Hi.
She's also going to be helping teaching them. The idea with these classes is we will teach you guys enough that you can become a judge at the end of the class if you want. But if you don't, you just want to come in, learn some of the rules, that is great also. We're happy to have you. So, there are, I think, 13 weeks in the class that we will be doing, and each week we will cover a different subject. And
before we get started, just for the stream, if there's anybody watching, I will be watching the Twitch chat. So if you have any questions, feel free to post any in there, and then we're just going to take some time every once in a while and answer the questions as they come up, and rather than doing it as they come in.
Yep.
So.
Okay. So this week we are covering the steps and phases in a turn. So there are steps and phases in a turn. Who knows what phases there are in a turn? Yes.
There are different points in the game where certain actions can and cannot happen.
Right. And what are they? Like, what are they called?
They're phases, right? Untap, upkeep, draw, your first main, attackers, blockers, damage, second main, end step cleanup.
Okay.
Is that all of them? Very close.
Very close, yes.
Okay.
So there are five phases in the turn, and the phases can be broken down into steps. So you mentioned there's the untap upkeep step, or steps. Those are part of the beginning phase, along with the draw step. Then there's your main phase one. There's the combat phase, which is broken down into beginning of combat, declare attackers, declare blockers, damage, and end of combat. It's kind of like a little baby turn. Then there's your post-combat main phase, or main phase two, followed by the end phase, which has your end step and the cleanup step. Okay, well, let's dive right in. Tony, can you pull up?
Absolutely. Cards?
In your untap step, two things happen. The first is phasing. Permanents with phasing will either phase in or phase out. And that's all we're talking about with phasing today. We might touch on it in some other classes, but that's it. No more phasing. And then things untap. Okay. This is our second card. It is the Arbiter of the Ideal and has the ability Inspired. Whenever Arbiter of the Ideal becomes untapped, reveal the top card of your library. If it is an if it's an artifact, creature, enchantment, artifact, creature, land, no enchantment, sadly, you may put it onto the battlefield with a manifestation counter on it. That permanent is an enchantment in addition to its other types.
I think that's why it's not enchantments, because it would be a double enchantment.
I'd be done with a double enchantment.
Right?
Twice as enchanting, right?
Sure.
Okay. So... who knows when this ability here would happen?
When it untaps during the untap step.
Very close. So neither player will receive priority in either the untap step and usually the cleanup step. There are a few weird exceptions we will get to when we get to the cleanup step, but no player receives priority then. And in order to have an ability trigger or be able to cast a spell, you need to get priority. So, this will trigger in the upkeep step. So in your upkeep step, first thing that happens is things that would have triggered in your untap step, or things that trigger at the beginning of your upkeep step, or if it's your opponent's turn, things that trigger at the beginning of your opponent's upkeep, will trigger. So
An untapped would trigger first before beginning of upkeep?
It would trigger in the upkeep step, but if you have two triggers that, like, this one triggers when it untaps and you have one that triggers at the beginning of your upkeep, you get to choose which
order. You can
pick
the order on the step?
Yeah.
Okay.
So if you had, like, a Mary's Guile, look at the top three cards and put them back in any order, you could have that go off first, so you would be guaranteed to hit an artifact, creature, or land card.
Okay.
Okay. Let's see. Untap triggers, beginning of upkeep triggers, and then we need to talk about how to change steps and phases. So when you change a step or a phase, you need to have both players pass priority in succession with nothing on the stack. So if something goes on the stack, then you need to restart, do the whole thing over again. And if you have any mana in your mana pool, it will empty as you move between steps and phases. So that gets us into our main phase. Let me go through my notes and see what the next card we're pulling up is.
Anything special about the draw phase?
That is right. Thank you. There's a draw phase.
Draw step.
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 It's okay.
There's a draw step, not a draw phase.
You're good.
Okay, yes. In your turn, there are certain turn-based actions that will happen. Those can be those are drawing a card, attacking with creatures, blocking with creatures, and there's like untapping, and I think there's discarding and cleanup. But these are actions that will happen automatically. They do not use the stack. You can't miss them. So it's, I forgot to draw my card. No, you have to draw your card. You can't forget to draw your card.
Yeah.
Yep. Or, I didn't untap, just kind of did it out of order.
It's not 1996 anymore.
So, you, first turn-based action, you draw a card, and what's your next card?
Do-do-do.
Then any triggers that trigger at the beginning of each player's draw step, or your draw step, or their draw step, will trigger. So, Howling Mine, beginning of each player's draw step. If Howling Mine is untapped, that player draws an additional card. So I'll draw my card for the turn, then Howling Mine will trigger, players can respond, I will draw my card from my Howling Mine. After that, we have our next... thing. No, you're good. So we have Vendilion Click, legendary fairy wizard with flash and other abilities.
Figured they'd show up.
Flying, and when it enters the battlefield, look at target player's hand. You can choose a non-land card from it. If you do, that player reveals the chosen card and puts it at the bottom of their library, then draws a card. So I cannot say, okay, now that you're out of your upkeep, before you draw, I want to do this. You'll either have to do it in your upkeep or in the draw step after they've drawn the first card for a turn. Any questions?
It doesn't make too much sense to do it at the beginning of their draw step, because you would have just done it in their upkeep anyways.
Yeah.
You're wanting to click them before they draw. Anyway.
No.
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions from the Twitch chat?
Not right now. This is a good place to stop, I think. Yeah. If you have any questions, let us know. If you have any questions about the audio, or if you can't see the pictures, I'll gladly put links in the page on the Twitch chat. I think we're good, Jeremiah.
Okay, great. That moves us into our main phase one. In your main phase one, you can do lots of things. You can cast sorceries, creatures, planeswalkers, artifacts. You can play land. You do this all at sorcery speed. Who knows what it means to do something at sorcery speed?
So
yes.
You cast it and it resolves before you can cast something else, unless it's an instant?
You're
close.
You're on the right track,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So when you're doing something at sorcery speed, you are doing it on your turn when you have priority in your main phase,
yep.
and when the stack is empty. So we'll talk about the stack more next week, I believe, when we talk about the different zones, but stack is empty, you can do something at sorcery speed. And if you want in your main phase, or any other phase, you can cast instants. Who knows, like, we just listed the requirements for casting a sorcery. Would anyone like to take a stab at the requirements for casting an instant?
It's probably along those lines, but the stack doesn't have to be empty. When you can cast an instant when you have priority.
Yeah.
At any point.
Yep, that's a big one. It's mostly whenever you have priority. Okay. Let's go to the next creature.
Alright, so just so you know.
Yes.
Cards on are not seen really well on stream, just because of the how far away the camera is, but that's okay. So we'll just make sure we read it and kind of explain the cards really thoroughly.
Okay. So we were just talking about things at instant speed. We have Aven Mind Sensor. He's a bird wizard for 2W. He has Flash, meaning you can cast him at instant speed.
My bad.
He has Flying, and he's in Standard right now, which is why we chose this card. He has the ability, if an opponent would search a library, that player instead looks at the searches the top four cards.
Let's read it.
If an opponent would search a library, that player searches the top four cards of that library instead.
Good job.
And he's a 2/1 creature, bird wizard. We like bird wizards.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
Get that altered to be a bird person from Rick and Morty.
Rick and Morty?
Yeah.
That's a great idea.
Okay, so.
Next one?
Next one. Sweltering Suns. It is a sorcery. So, again, cast it on your turn during your first or second main phase, as long as you have priority, and
stack's clear.
The stack is clear. Thank you. Okay.
But you can cycle it at instant speed, right?
Right.
Okay.
That's one of the things. It has the cycling ability, which can be done at instant speed. So, anytime you have priority, you can cycle the card. Okay. And let's go on to the next one.
Gonna find the mouse. There it is.
Okay. Honored Hydra. It's 5 green for a creature snake Hydra with trample. And it's a 6/6. And it has embalm for 3 green. With embalm, you can exile this card from your graveyard and create a token that's a copy of it, except it's a white zombie snake Hydra with no mana cost. And you can embalm only as a sorcery. So, like we just mentioned, anytime you have priority on your turn, stack is empty. I guess not necessarily on your turn, during your first or second main phase. Okay. Do you have any more for this? He has cycling. That's why he's in here. We got the cycling earlier with the Sweltering Suns.
Perfect.
Great.
All right, next one.
Okay. It's Waste Knot.
Who doesn't like Waste Knot?
Card designed by the Magic community. For 1W, you get an enchantment that says whenever an opponent discards a creature card, create a 2/2 zombie creature token. Whenever an opponent discards a land card, add black to your mana pool. Whenever an opponent discards a non-creature non-land card, draw a card. So I mentioned earlier, you do not normally get priority during the cleanup step in addition to the untap step. However, if during your cleanup step you discard a card, mentioned you have to do something before you triggered abilities go off. And that is state-based actions checked and
yeah.
Both players get priority once it goes on the stack. So you would get priority and you can discard a card and draw a card again.
And it's state-based because it's sitting on the battlefield, so it's always checking?
State-based actions, there's a list of them, so like, whenever a player, before a player would receive priority, It will check all the state-based actions. It can be if a creature has zero or less toughness, if a effect set destroy a creature, if a planeswalker has zero loyalty counters on it, checks life, and it'll just check all of those. And we will, at another, in a future lesson, talk about the state-based actions and how it relates to triggered abilities and priority. But good question, though. Thank you. Okay. Think we're good with this card? Do we have any questions from the chat?
No.
Well, so
right
during
now, just technicals.
Yeah.
During the cleanup step, so that does trigger when they're discarded.
Yes, it does.
Okay.
And then you'll have priority, and after that, the cleanup step will happen again.
Okay.
So, if for some reason you discard it, your opponent, well, no, I guess that one. There's the Gitrog monster. If you discard a card,
it's constantly checking, so you can discard a land. The frog will trigger, allowing you to draw a card, which you then have to rediscard back down to hand size.
Yeah.
And you can kind of go in with that. But yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so for those of you who were paying attention, we did skip the combat because there is a lot to cover in combat. Like I mentioned at the beginning of the lesson, combat is kind of like its own baby turn. So, in the regular turn, we have the untap, upkeep, draw steps. In combat, we start off with the beginning of combat step. So, cards that say, at the beginning of combat on your turn, that would trigger. I don't know if we mentioned this before, but I don't think we did. Triggered abilities are abilities that have when, whenever, or at. And they will trigger at specific times or when conditions are met. Such as, like, the Gitrog, whenever a land is put into the graveyard, draw a card. So this one triggers at the beginning of combat. 200 red, enchantment, at the beginning of combat on your turn, you may have target creature you control get +2/+0, and gain haste until the end of turn. If you do, sacrifice it at the beginning of the next end step. So, things trigger at the beginning of combat, and then there are other things you can do. Tony, would you mind moving over to the next one? You can crew vehicles! But not this one in standard.
You have to announce it correctly now.
They've actually fixed that.
They have actually fixed that?
Yep.
Oh, thank goodness.
Smuggler's Copter costs 2 generic mana. And it's an artifact vehicle with flying, and whenever Smuggler's Copter attacks or blocks, you may draw a card. If you do, discard a card.
It's so busted.
It has crew 1. Tap any number of creatures you control with total power 1 or more. This vehicle becomes an artifact creature until end of turn. And it becomes a 3/3. So you can crew this at beginning of combat, so you can attack them. If, for example, they floated mana at the... had mana floating at your end phase, and you're like, or not your end phase, end of main phase, and you're like, oh, I don't want to walk into the trap. Let's go to my beginning of combat so your pool empties and you don't have any shenanigans. Okay, let's go to the next picture. Next card.
It's a pretty picture, though.
So pretty. We have Skin Invasion. So, after the beginning of combat, you will move to the Declare Attacker step. In the Declare Attacker step, one of the turn-based actions, very first thing you do in it is you will declare which creatures you are attacking with. Then both players receive priority. If you don't want to do anything, pass, go to the Declare Blocker step. And I'm going to skip through these, then we'll get back to this card. Or not skip through these, kind of go through them real quick. In the Declare Blockers step, you have the turn-based action of I declare which blockers are blocking, and then there will be the turn-based action of the attacker gets to order the way the damage will be dealt to creatures. After that, there is the damage step, where damage happens and creatures or players die. Hopefully opponents, hopefully not you. Fingers crossed for you. And after that, there is the end of combat step. Things that trigger at the end of combat will trigger here. And there's a couple other fun shenanigans we'll get into later. So, back to Skin Invasion. It costs one red, it's an enchantment aura, and it has enchanted creature attacks each combat if able. That's the important part. Other than that, when enchanted creature dies, return Skin Invasion to the battlefield, transformed under your control. So I've got my very pretty Skin Invasion, and let's put it on the next creature that's going to pop up. Yeah, that one. Bantu the Glorified.
<He's> doesn't work.
Two and a black, legendary creature god. She has menace and indestructible. And Bantu can't attack or block unless a creature died under your control this turn. Then for one and a black, you can sacrifice another creature, scry one. Each opponent loses one life and you gain one life. Has a power and toughness of 4 and 6. So, I've got my Skin Invasion enchanting my Bantu, and it can't attack or block unless I sacrifice, unless a creature died this turn. Question is, do I have to sacrifice another creature? Because
no. It's
an ability. No?
That's an activated ability. You can choose not to activate the ability. If able on Skin Invasion prevents that from happening. Because it is not currently able to attack or block unless a creature died.
Okay. Yep. Correct. Let's go to the next one, because I kind of want to enchant this creature with the Skin Invasion now. Nope, I don't want to enchant this creature with the Skin Invasion. Let's skip that one momentarily.
Did we miss one?
No. Bonded Construct.
There it is.
Bonded Construct can't attack alone. It costs one mana. It's an artifact creature construct, and it is a 2/1. So, I've got my Skin Invasion on my Bonded Construct. It must attack each turn if able, and it can't attack alone. Let's say I also have a Grizzly Bears. One in green, 2/2, lots of flavor text, very pretty. I don't want my Grizzly Bear to attack because you have a 2/12 wall for some reason. It's an attacking wall, but it's a 2/12. Do I have to attack with both the Grizzly Bear and the Bonded Construct?
The enchantment shouldn't be affecting the creature that it's not enchanted to, unless it says all or... So the enchantment's only going to affect your Bonded Construct. It cannot attack alone. So just like Bantu, there's something preventing it from attacking. It cannot attack.
That is close. In
right?
This case, we would have to attack with the Grizzly Bear.
What?
Because we have the option of allowing the Bonded Construct to attack this turn if able, the Grizzly Bear has attack with
that's
it.
That's the worst.
Sadly, the Grizzly Bear will be in by the 2/12 wall or the Bonded Construct, but then you get the weird 4/3.
I mean, they could make a bad block and block your Bonded Construct and have you get a thing.
I know, right? Of course, it's probably their thing on your Bonded Construct to kill off the Grizzly Bear. Elaborate plot. Okay.
That's silly.
Let's go back to the one before.
Ghostly Prison?
Yes, Ghostly Prison. Ghostly Prison then is an enchantment for 2 and a white, and it says creatures can't attack you unless their controller pays 2 for each attacking creature he or she controls that's attacking you. Okay, so with this one, does this fall more into the Bantu category of my thing didn't die, or does this fall into the category of the Bonded Construct and the Grizzly Bear? If my, we'll go with the Grizzly Bear, is enchanted with the Skin Invasion, do I have to pay the mana to have him attack?
It's like Bantu, because you have to pay mana, right?
No.
No?
Because you have the mana available. It is available to pay. The Grizzly Bear can attack, so you must pay and make it attack.
Okay. So you're kind of both right on this one.
Oh no.
With this, I have to pay if I can. It doesn't say anything about having to tap lands to add mana to my mana pool. So
we are quibbling to the most quibbly
what?
Extent.
Yes, we are.
If I have two mana floating, I have to attack and pay.
Oh, okay.
If I don't have any mana floating but I have lands available, I can be like, nope, I don't want to pay it.
Okay.
Otherwise, like, you're like, well, strategy, I'll just...
I thought that's how it worked initially, where, like, you don't... players can't force you to tap mana.
Right.
But...
you can't be forced
but
to
I was,
tap
But I was so baffled by...
Yeah.
The other thing where the grizzly bear just had to attack.
I could tap your mountain all day long.
So
was it like mana short, I think?
Yeah.
What it is? Yeah.
If you have floating mana on Bantu, do you have to sacrifice your creature?
No, because like we don't have to tap the lands, we don't have to activate Bantu's ability.
Okay. Because there's something else besides the mana cost with the activation.
Right, yeah. Okay. And let's go back to the one before it. Expose evil for one and a blue.
White,
thank you. There's blue art. This is more or less a blue card. Feels very blue to me.
Yeah.
It does.
Despite the whiteness. It's an instant speed. You can tap up to two target creatures and then investigate. We don't care about the investigate. But if I attack you with two grizzly bears. If I attack you with two grizzly bears, and then you cast this card, something.
Expose evil.
Targeting both the grizzly bears, what happens?
Well, you've let them declare as attackers, so they are still attacking.
They are still attacking. That is correct.
That's why at the beginning of combat step, there's more than just green vehicles that you can do. Like, you'll want to tap those creatures before they declare attackers.
Correct. Okay, so yeah. You can target them. You can do that. Unfortunately, the best effect you will get out of that action is you will investigate. And I don't know, maybe you do want a clue token. But
who's the best?
That was the first ruling with Gather. Is it says up to two target creatures.
Mm-hmm.
So you can choose zero targets and still pay one and a white to get a clue token.
Woohoo! Okay, let's see. We did the Expose Evil, we did the Ghostly Prison, we did the Construct. What do we have after that? Ooh, fun! Okay, so, after we've declared attacks, we've declared blocks, we do damage. So, I am at 12 life. You have attacked me for 13. And I block one of your 1/1s of the 13 1/1s you are attacking me with an Exalted Angel. Exalted Angel is a 4 white-white. It's a creature angel with flying, and it has whenever Exalted Angel deals damage to you, you gain that much life. It has morph for 2 white-white, so you can cast it face down as a 2/2 creature for free and turn it face up anytime for its morph cost. And it is a 4/5. So, I block one of your 1/1, probably Sapperlings, those seem to get out of hand fast, with my Exalted Angel and let 12 through while I'm at 12 life. What happens?
Well, creatures will deal their damage during the damage step.
Yep.
You will fall to 0 life.
Okay.
Will state-based check there to see, oh, you have 0 life?
It would check before we move to phases, because
yeah.
Both players would get priority.
But the stack's not empty, though, because Exalted Angel is a trigger when it deals damage.
Right, but state-based actions would check before damage, or not, before we would trigger. So, am I alive or am I dead?
You're still dead.
Okay. Very nice, because this is a triggered ability, I would die. Same scenario, but this time we'll block with a Sacred Cat. It is a white for a creature cat. That's a 1/1. It has lifelink and embalm for a white, so we can exile it from our graveyard. create a token that's a copy of it, except it's a white zombie cat with no mana cost, and we can embalm only as a sorcery.
Lifelink is different because you gain the life when it actually deals the damage.
Correct. So we
doesn't
would
use the stack. It's just
yeah, you're right on. Damage would check. Lifelink would say, "Hey, you gain a life. You are not dead. You are at one life." Okay. I have one more card that I didn't put up by accident. Can you scroll up and search Celestial Flare?
This card's cute.
This card's fun.
You guys are going to see my poor diving skills. Celestial. Spell it.
I-A-L.
Yeah.
Flare?
Yeah. Ari.
Yeah. Sweet. Okay. This is an instant for white-white. Target player sacrifices an attacking or blocking creature. I want to cast this at the last possible moment. What step or phase can I still cast this in to have a player sacrifice an attacking creature?
During, before you leave the damage step.
So before we leave the damage step?
Creatures are still attacking during combat. After they've been declared an attacker, until combat is done, those creatures are attacking.
So,
right?
Yes, you are right on that.
Okay.
But is it the damage step, or what comes after that?
It's the end of combat.
Right, so can I cast that in the end of combat?
Yes.
Because, like you said, the creature is still attacking.
So you can do some fun tricks with blocking. If you want, since it says target player sacrifices an attacking creature, if you make your blocks right, so that they only have like the one creature you want to kill that has like hexproof, you can kill it with a Celestial Flare.
Right. Okay.
Good work.
Well, that's all I've got tonight for the steps and phases in a turn. Does anyone have any questions?
Zero from Twitch chat. Anything from there?
You may want to spend just a little bit of time on first strike and double strike and what that does to the combat damage. No, I'm sorry, not to the...
Yeah, to the combat damage stuff.
So, if a creature has first strike or double strike, there will be an additional damage phase thrown in, and in the first one, first strike and double strike damage will be dealt. And then there's other fun shenanigans that we will be talking about when we talk about evergreen abilities.
So first strike, it's like a sub-step that doesn't really...
It is there all the time. This step happens all the time. It's just
you don't see it unless
a
creature
has first
strike.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So yeah.
And double strike's not its own thing. It just does normal damage after doing set. After
which we'll
doing
talk about a little bit
damage.
More in future when we go over combat a little bit more explicitly. We just kind of want to keep it at general as the steps of the turns.
So
yeah.
For an extra step like that, though. There's no priority pass for the first strike unless first strike's happening, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, because then it gets weird. You're like, I declare no blocks. Now that you didn't cast any pump spells, I'll kill your guy. Or now that you did cast a pump spell.
Yeah.
It gets a little weird. But, yeah, all of the steps and phases will happen, except for the draw step on the first player's first turn. That one is skipped.
Mm-hmm.
But they will happen, regardless of whether or not
it didn't used to. I was listening to Kitchen Table Magic about, he was interviewing a guy about the deck.
Uh-huh.
And how you used to be able to draw on your first turn and have library.
Mm-hmm.
That was, yeah. Anyways.
Sweet.
Fun facts.
Fun facts. Sweet. Any, Kai, do you have anything before we...
I think the only other thing in my notes that hasn't been mentioned is that if no attackers are declared, that's one of the very few times in the game where you actually skip
steps
entirely.
Yeah, you would skip the blocker step
yep.
there
mm-hmm.
and the damage step.
Yep.
Okay.
And so, and most tabletop magic games are very different than what we're talking about, if you guys think about it. Most of it's very... We use shortcuts in those circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't normally be like, hey, I pass priority to you, Jeremiah. Can I go to my next phase?
I pass priority. Do you pass priority? We are now moving to the next phase.
We don't really play Magic that way, but it's good to know that does happen, because there are times that you can interact. It kind of helps you.
Yep.
So it's good. It's good to know those. And
I mean, you can use that lingo, but
sometimes it's necessary. Sometimes it's necessary. Sometimes it's not. Yeah. But
okay. Well, if you are watching this and it's not Wednesday night, feel free to request to join our Facebook page. What was that called, Tony?
Utah Judge Classes. Something like that.
Yeah. If you have any questions about the steps and phases of a turn, ask them there. We will answer them.
Yeah, you can talk to a rep at Paragon City Games. And we'll get you hooked up with the right people.
That was the next thing. Yep, that was the next thing I was going to mention. Feel free to send a message to the stream here, and they'll get you to the right people. Thanks again for Paragon for hosting us.
Yes, go Paragon.
Those guys are great. They gave us a free place to come and stream at. It's awesome.
Woo!
Yeah, thank you guys. If there's not any questions from the chat, we'll take off then. And we'll see you at the same time, same channel, next week. Same bat time, same bat channel. That's kind of it. I like it. That's our new send off. See you later.
Bye guys.
Have a good one.
See ya.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone. You guys rock.
Woo.
Yeah, this will be good to be able to review and watch it later too.
Yeah.
Especially if you're a visual learner.